are the ones who actually get things done in this world. Enthusiasm is what turns any idea into reality, and it is linked closely with happiness. A very heartiest good evening to everybody present over here. I, Nitya Chettiar.
And I, Jainit Mandoth, will be your host for this evening. And we extend a gracious welcome to all of you on behalf of Purnima University to the 59th Annual NASA Convention.
This prestigious event started on 16 January 2017, focusing on providing a platform for architecture students to learn and interact. All of us witnessed knowledge-enhancing sessions and dazzling memorable events. Hearing from the honorable erudite, observing excellent presentations of the students from different colleges. All these will remain with us all through our lives. We are glad and honored to be a part of this historic event.
On the last day of the convention, we are going to have a keynote session related to landscape architecture.
Yeah, whenever we hear this term, a picture that comes into our minds is of landscape design, site planning, stormwater management, environmental restoration, parks, and so on. Though they sound quite monotonous, but from architectural perspective, it's quite interesting and offers plethora of knowledge and practical experience. So I feel honored to welcome our esteemed chief guest, Architect Vallari Talapatra.
Architect Vallari is a professional, creative, expert designer, and an artist. Her professional title is President at Scapes Incorporated, which specializes in landscape design and installation. It mainly focuses on design and implementation of natural and landscaping solutions in Chicagoland area. And she led a large-scale initiative to enhance natural areas, stormwater management, and promote sustainable sites.
She is teaching since 1996 at local arboretum and since 2005 at Community College. Prior to Scapes Incorporate, she has worked with Army Corporation of Engineers in UIUC, Ecologic and Environmental Consulting Firm, and taught landscape architecture in School of Continuing Studies at Northwestern University, Chicago.
She received her master's degree in landscape architecture from University of Illinois, USA, and bachelor's degree in architecture from SPA, Delhi.
Currently, she is also involved with South Asian Women's Conference and American Society of Landscape Architecture. She is drawn to and passionate about charitable organizations such as Feed My Starving Children and American Diabetes Foundation.
So, this is a great opportunity for all of us to enlighten ourselves with her knowledgeable yet fascinating experiences.
Let us waste no more time and invite her to the dais with warmth in our hearts and with a big round of applause.
Hello, I am so thrilled to be here. It's been an honor and a privilege to see all of your works. I went around today to look at some of the drawings, and I was just really fascinated with all of the new stuff that's happening in architecture. I just wanted to actually let you know that this is my fourth NASA, the first three being almost two decades ago. But this one sure feels really different. There's way more people now than when I went to NASA in the 1990s. I just want to actually share my story and also kind of explain to you why I passionately feel that landscape architectural solutions matter now more than ever before. And you guys are actually at the right time and in the right profession. Landscape architecture basically deals with these three units: landform, vegetation, and water. And the reason why landscape architecture matters so much is because working with nature pays far-reaching dividends. I'm here today to actually share this knowledge of working with nature and trying to create sustainable landscapes. And the thing that I want to actually stress on most is reading the site. I want to tell you a series of short stories through my projects and other renowned projects that you guys are probably already familiar with, to just elucidate this point of why reading the site makes all the difference. Reading the site can actually make a very ordinary project into an extraordinary one. When we talk about sustainability, and you've probably heard this term many times repeated through this last 1 week, but as it pertains to landscape design and landscape architecture, sustainability basically means when a design is long-lived, when it's diverse, when it's productive, and when it has the capacity to endure. So I'm going to ask you guys, the audience, do you think that this landscape is natural or man-made? What do you think? Okay, I heard some people say man-made, and that's right, it is man-made. Which one of these woodlands is natural? Is it the one on the right or the one on the left? Very true. So the one on the left is natural. Good job, guys. So the thing that I want to actually make you aware, though, is that even though both of these are woodlands, one is natural, the other is man-made, they're both actually sustainable. And the reason is because they're both self-healing. When I talk about reading the site, I am asking you to actually do the following. I'm asking you to look beyond your plot. So when I talk of reading the site, it's not just plain old site analysis 101 that we do at architectural colleges. I'm asking you to do a little bit more. I'm asking you to establish the context. I'm asking you to evaluate the terrain and the geography of the place, to understand the unique aspects of the site. I feel that every site has a story, and some people can just read the site better than others. Here's one of them, Frank Lloyd Wright's Falling Water. This is from Magarpatta City in Pune. This is Meadow Lake at the Morton Arboretum. These are all projects that have really a genius loci or a sense of place with them. And these are all projects where the designers and the planners read the site. I'm going to now show you three slides of the exact opposite, where the site was not really read. This is in Madrid. This is in Gurgaon, and this is in Delhi. So for the last 25 years, I've been working on this field of sustainable landscapes, and I've basically simplified my design process into this two-pronged approach. I truly believe that the simplest solutions are the best solutions. I'm not going to really pay too much focus on reading the client. I'm here today to talk more about reading the site. But I'll just take 2 minutes to elucidate a point about why I think that reading the client and reading the site makes for a really well-designed space. So this is a project that I started in 1996, the very first time when I started my own practice. This is an 80-year-old artist. Her name is Rosie Dixon. She has a historic Shaker-style house, and she wanted a tall grass prairie because she wanted a low-maintenance garden. So I went ahead and did that. But what I also took to do is to take the next step. I wanted to celebrate the client. And since she was a great-grandmother, she had gifts that she wanted to put in her yard. She had a labyrinth pendant from her brother who she lost at war. And so I chose to actually do a labyrinth in her backyard. This particular project was actually showcased in a national landscape design magazine. And the reason that I wanted to share this little story with you is because I'm asking you to actually take that little further step where you listen to the client. The client can be just one person or a conglomerate or a large city. It doesn't matter, but the principles remain the same. Similarly, in 1996, my very first time that I started my company, a small site, it's just a 9-acre site, and there was a chance to actually read the site in terms of placing the house on a mound and to be able to actually take advantage of the borrowed landscape, the landscape that surrounded the site, and the importance of site planning. So I was able to put a drainage swale right around the base because I was reading the site and trying to find out the topography in a way where the storm water could just be naturally drained away. And also learning from nature and trying to design in a way where you wouldn't be able to actually tell whether this was man-made or this was natural. So I'm gonna flit through different geographies and different scales to kind of show you that no matter where, the principles still remain the same. The first project that I'm gonna talk about is very dear to me. I'm actually still involved in this. It's the community of Prairie Crossing. So this is a community that is based on landscape conservation. The project was envisioned in 1987 and began in 1992, finished in 1995. The guiding principles in this particular project was to come up with a sustainable design. And to do that, we started with native landscaping first, which led to the ecological restorations and then to the habitat restorations. In this particular community, open space takes precedence. 622 acres, the created prairie was 41%, the organic farms was 21%, the created lake, which happens to be the retention basin, is 5%. Add it all up. 70%. 70% of it was open space and 30% was homes. This project is now touted as a great success by not only the Journal of Landscape Architecture, but also by new urbanists. And the reason why this works is because it preserves the natural ecology, it works with the existing lay of the land, there is a sense of place here, the habitats for birds and animals were created, and all of this was done by the community being engaged and involved in this. So the principles of new urbanism basically relates to the homes being a very traditional type of design, and the streets being a scale where it feels like a neighborhood, and there are common greens. In this particular case, there were also planted swales, vegetative swales along streets. There were trails of different widths. So there were walking trails that were wide enough for just walking. There were trails that were wide enough for running and walking. And then there were trails for bike rides. We really focused on adding native plants that would actually sustain or bring back the monarch butterflies and create a habitat for goldfinches and blackbirds. This was a one-of-a-kind sanctuary pond that was created in the community. It's actually the first breeding refuge in Illinois. And there was a species of fish that was dying that was brought in here. And 5 years down the line, the fish have survived and have multiplied. So the sanctuary project was actually awarded a conservation award in 2011. The sanctuary pond drains into Lake Aldo Leopold. This is the retention basin that's at the heart of the community. It's a 22-acre lake, all man-made, of course, just there to be a retention pond or a catch basin. And the reason why the water that you see so clean and so pure is because of what is surrounding it. It's the native plants that have really long root systems that take the pollutants away. And you can also see that there are some created sandy beaches, and the kids love to play in it. So this is what was created, a stormwater train. The vegetative swales from the streets drained the stormwater into the wetland, from the wetland to the Aldo Leopold Lake, which is basically a retention basin. These are the community common greens where you can see the walking trails, and then you can see the steps actually that are going down to the water line. Sort of reminds you of the ghats that we have here, right? These pictures that I've taken were taken in the end of April when it was like 35 degrees Fahrenheit outside. So you don't see people there. You also don't see leaves on the trees. So, but in the summer, trust me, there are people all over the place. They're all down by the water and they're engaged. As they are engaged in their parks too. And so at Prairie Crossing, there's also a charter school, sort of going in the same vein as new urbanism, which a lot of you might always already know the principles of new urbanism, but it focuses on being an inward community and being a sustainable community. And I will show you the actual farm and silo that's been totally revamped, which houses this charter school. But I want to take a few moments to actually share with you this mural that was created by the middle school. Middle school means they're from the sixth grade to the eighth grade. You can see them actually engaged in seeding the prairie, raking the soil to give the seed to soil contact. And they were asked to actually demonstrate what the prairie means to them. And this was a project that I did with the kids at their school to just make them aware of how important the prairie is and what they can do to actually maintain and manage the prairie. And that's what they came up with. In the most basic level, every home at Prairie Crossing has a rain garden in the front yard. And their patios are made of permeable pavers, which means that they're not made of concrete, so they're actually semi-pervious or pervious. And they have vegetative swales that link up to the wetland that I spoke of before. And the agricultural urbanism, which makes the community bond even more, because there's 100 acres of site that was given away to actually create these organic farms, and everybody contributes a bit per year, and they grow the food together, and then they get to distribute it. So this type of agricultural urbanism is actually on the rise, and it's really wonderful to see a community come together on this issue. This is the Byron Colby farm. This is an old farm built in the 1880s, and it was totally revamped, and it's where the charter school is. But in order to make the building more efficient, they use it for gatherings and also to host weddings, etc., over weekends and evenings. The next project that I'm going to talk about is something that's going to make you aware how reading the site creates the spirit of a place, and why reading the site is so important to create a space that has genius loci. I'm going to take you to Taliesin West in Scottsdale, Arizona, and that is the site where Frank Lloyd Wright created Taliesin West. You see in the Google Earth image that I have put forward, these mountain ranges that are sort of, they kind of look like the Aravallis. They are the McDowell mountain range. And right where the red dot is the Taliesin West. Now, picture in 1922 when Frank Lloyd Wright steps into the zone. He looks at the space and has the ability to conceive that he's going to actually build his studios and home right here. It's in the middle of nowhere. There's no access roads, nothing. But he has the vision. And guess what? He's a master site reader. So his buildings are in harmony with its settings. He uses local stones and creates cooling techniques in the hot Arizona sun. Let's look at this project a little bit more carefully. You see the angular form of the architecture, and this was built in 1937. And you can see how the architecture just really fits right into the McDowell Mountain Range. When you look at the picture, you can almost see that the built form is emanating or coming out of the mountain range. I had the good fortune of being there in November of 2015, which is when I took these pictures. And what I found there was this amazing sense of place. And I wanted to share this with you guys because this is what happens. This is exactly what happens when you read the site. So I'm asking you to actually look beyond your plot, see what surrounds you. This is what makes for memorable spaces. This is what makes for meaningful architecture. Wright's projects are always very site-specific. In this particular instance, however, his low-lying architectural form is not just site-specific and aesthetically pleasing, but it also ensures natural ventilation and cooling, which is essential in the Arizona sun. But I want to really talk about this wall, which is absolutely a piece of art in itself. I actually had the good fortune to walk around with some of you volunteers today and looked at all the artwork that's been done through the NASA, the last 1 week of your convention. And I was just blown away. So I know that you have the artist's eye. And I want you to look at the orange trims of Taliesin West House, the orange in that round door that he's created. Now look at the orange that it picks on from the wall stone. These stones are actually local desert rocks which are stacked within a wood frame filled with concrete. Now remember, Wright favored these than bringing in material from outside the site. He really wanted to go completely hardcore indigenous. And the best thing about this whole project is that he takes these large rocks with beautiful petroglyphs on them and literally celebrates them. So here's another example of how he's not just reading the site, but he's also able to take out little nuggets and give them so much importance. He is also a master manipulator of light and shadow. And you can see from the clear stories above, and you can see from these wide eaves that are casting those really wide shadows. You're all familiar with the chajjas and the way the narrow streets work in Jaisalmer. But this is Arizona. The desert hot sun is kind of similar. And he's taking advantage of these other techniques, like the wide eaves, the canvases that roll down those clear stories to make it really cool and habitable. And I hope you can now also appreciate the angular forms of his furnishings. Take a look at the furniture that he's designed in there. That is also in angular form, just as the built form, just as the landscape outside, right down to the little details. The next project is also of another masterful sight reader. In this case, the scale is a little bit bigger. It's urban design. But I'm going to show you how, again, because he read the site well, he's able to create an urban design feature that stands the test of time. This chapter is called Form Follows Function, and you'll know that, you know why in a second. I'm talking about Lutyens Delhi. It's bold, functional, memorable, and yes, extremely sustainable. So Lachin's Deli, as you guys know, perhaps, started in 1911, finished 1947, just when we were getting our independence. The first phase, however, which started in 1911, dealt with the central axis. This is the central axis. And I basically want you to come with me through this journey. Let's unpeel the onion. Why did he choose this site? This is why. So Lutyens basically figured out on the east is the Yamuna River, on the west is the ridge, the catchment basically. So he finds this beautiful low-lying space, a little bit undulating. You know, the Raisina Hill where the Rashtrapati Bhavan is situated is a mound, but pretty much flat and drains really well. So he finds this beautiful low-lying spot and he wants to, put on his hexagonal grid, very much in line with the Garden City movement that was going around at that time. And the geometry that he does, the hexagonal grid that he puts in, has tremendous meaning. The strong central axis that lines up the Rashtrapati Bhavan to the Purana Kila, the axis that has a visual linkage with the Jama Masjid, and then on the right with the Safdarjung Tomb. Now what Lutyens is doing by doing this is that he's actually integrating these gems from the 15th, 16th, and the 17th century AD. These amazing architectural pieces, he's connecting them to his own strong axis. And remember that this Rashtrapati Bhavan, which was then the Viceroy's house, sits on Raisina Hill, which in itself is a mound. The other thing that I want you to look at and understand is that he actually reinforced his strong axis by having this really linear vista with double-lined jamun trees on either side to actually accentuate that strong axis. So he has a linear form, then he goes ahead and double downs and reinforces it with this beautiful vista and beautiful landscape. He doesn't just stop there. He goes into zoning. The LBZ or the Lutyens buildings bungalow zone is a zone that he prescribes to keep the built form not more than two-story high. Now, by doing that, what he achieves is the feeling that if you are a pedestrian walking through those streets, you're not going to actually perceive any built form because all you're going to see are the trees and it's going to look really lush. Not sure how many of you have read Image of a City by Kevin Lynch. But he talks about these four elements, paths, nodes, landmarks, and edges. And Lutyens totally gets that. He designs these nodes on his hexagonal grid, and he has all the other elements to make them imageable. And notice also the hierarchy of streets. The one thing I want to point out is one of the reasons why Lutyens Deli is still working, by the way, now, is because he was very progressive. His large streets were designed as 6 carriage wide, and therefore they're actually even functional today. But let's now look at another layer. This is why this project is interesting to me. This is why I want to discuss it in this forum. Why is this place 5 degrees cooler? It's not because of these chadars of water that are lining up the central vista. Those chadars of water are actually based on the Mughal garden principles, which Lutyens took right into the Rashtrapati Bhavan as well. But it's because of the generous allocation of green spaces. And this is considered as a successful design for all of us as landscape architects, as urban planners, and urban designers. When we get to see our gardens being used by people, when we get to see people loving these outdoor spaces that are created, our job is done. Let's get back to Lutyens' leafy corridors and unpeel that onion and try to figure out why is it that on every hot day, the central PWD offices have kept records to see that Lakshin's Deli is 5 degrees cooler. Not just that, there's very little stormwater issues. The green spaces help in intercepting the rainwater, thereby limiting stormwater runoff. This is why. It's the giving tree, you guys. It's the trees. Provides oxygen, soaks up rain, lowers temperature, increases groundwater recharge, reduces pollutants, helps infiltration, thereby reducing runoff. That's what trees do. I want to talk about Jamunwalon ki said. This is actually a blogger, in fact, that I found online. He talks about these sars that happen in Delhi during the jamun season. And Latians chose jamun as the trees to line his central vista. It's not by chance. Jamun is a long living tree. The fruits of jamun have medicinal properties. More importantly, the transpiration rate on jamuns is much higher than other trees. Not to mention the living legacy. Look at this. You have a migrant worker from Bihar selling those jamuns at the Central Vista. You have little kids climbing on top of those trees. You have other people trying to shake the tree to catch the jamun. This is what urban design should be. It should engage people. It should have a ceremonial purpose. But more importantly and most importantly, it should be such that everyone feels that there is a sense of place. Lodhi Gardens is also a part of Latian's Delhi. And we know that the Lodhi Gardens were built in the 15th and 16th century by Syed and Lodhi rulers. But sometimes what we miss is that it was actually rehabilitated by Latians and his team. Because when after about 2 decades of the Lodhi Garden, it became a squatter settlement. So what the British government did is they actually moved the people to the peripheries and reclaimed Lodhi Gardens. Lodhi Gardens was redesigned by J.A. Stein and Garrett Egbo in 1968. And this is what it is right now. It is basically a draw for people from all over the world. There's about 2,000 different types of species here. There's bird habitats, there's critters, there's all kinds of butterfly, and most importantly, people love it. So let's move to something that goes wrong when you don't read the site. And this also happens to be in Delhi. This is the city that I come from. I love Delhi, by the way. But this could be happening in any other city in India. And I'm talking about stormwater management. So this is what happens when we ignore reading the site. In particular, I'm talking about the Barapulla flyover. Now, I don't know if you know this, but Delhi has 3 major nalas that take the stormwater away into Yamuna. Barapulla Nala is one of them. Well, guess what we did? We went and built a flyover on top of it. This is the Times of India article that talks about the ticking time bomb under Barapulla. So we cannot actually go and build on top of nalas. This is what happens on the streets of all our cities, not just Delhi. Stormwater falls on the road surface, quickly collected in roadside drains, to the nalas, straight to the rivers. This is a quick map of Delhi to show how the stormwater falls on roads going to the closest nalas. This is a little graphic demonstration to show you guys how permeable surfaces turn into impermeable surface because of urbanization. 75 to 100% of our surfaces in the cities are impermeable. There's only 10% deep infiltration. Keep that in mind when I go through the next couple of case studies, by the way. This is what current stormwater management looks like. So the water falls on the street and just simply goes to the nearby nala. There's no groundwater recharge. And when it's plugged, well, guess what? you flood the streets. This is a headline from the Hindustan Times, September 2016. Drainage networks, not roads, are the arteries of the city. So if drainage networks are the arteries of the cities, why are we clogging our arteries? And what happens when we clog arteries? We choke. And that's what's happening to our cities. So we have to find sustainable solutions for our stormwater management. We have to minimize runoff, catch stormwater locally, treat it at the source, convey it naturally through these dry creek beds, and then have natural stormwater treatment. This is the conventional road section. You can see how the stormwater just goes right directly into the rivers, along with all the pollutants, might I add. And this is what it should look like, with greens so that they actually take the water and replenish it into the water table so that there's maximum groundwater recharge. This is how you could insert swales or planters into existing streets. This is how you could actually convert roads into stormwater filters and rain gardens. This is a pet peeve of mine, by the way. I go into Noida or Gurgaon and they have these huge housing complexes and I'm told that, the central part is all open space. Well, under the central open space are these basements or swimming pools or car parks or garages. To me, that's not an open space. It's a roof garden. And if you are doing a park or an open space, you should have zero runoff. And you should really avoid doing this. You should also try to do watershed mapping. You should also try to do watershed maps of cities, either digitally or manually. And try to make nalas or drains a hub of life. This is how it looks before. This is how it could look. And this is how it looks in a city in Stockholm, Sweden. These are some of the ways that I've tried to deal with it. You see the parking lots with prairie or other types of landscapings. Those are birch trees. All of them increase infiltration. So it can actually look really attractive, which leads me to explain to you why plants are really powerful and why for successful stormwater management, you would need to use bioswales. In order to make that point, I want to zoom into one of my projects here in Elgin, Illinois. This project, you can see just from the Google Earth image, the large amount of parking space that is adjacent to the built form. Also adjacent to the built form is Tyler Creek. Tyler Creek is a pristine creek that houses trout, and it's the trout fishers go there, and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service actually monitors this creek. And they found that the trout population was dying there. So the clients contacted us and asked us to do something about it. So here's what we did. We did stormwater retention basins. The basins, these are shots that I took in winter. So there are trails around those retention ponds that are being used by the employees. And then right down that bioswale is the Tyler Creek. So we did these serpentine bioswales with gravel in order to trap the pollutants. And literally in 2 years, the trout population was back. Now, when you deal with landscape architecture, when you deal with natural areas landscaping, there are most often you do not see the results quickly. It takes many years for us to understand if a project was successful. But in this instant, within 2 years, we were able to find out that the project was a success. Thank you so much. So bioswales slow the runoff velocity, cleanse the water, recharges the underlying groundwater table. And it also takes care of the first flush. I don't know if you guys know this, but the first flush is the one that's most polluted. And bioswales are a great way of taking care of that. These are some other examples of bioswales in much smaller capacities. And you could see a cross-section of a bioswale where you could actually use gravel. In the Tyler Creek project, we did use gravel, but in many other instances, I've done it just simply with plants, and you can do it both ways. So here you can see how it's the same project where we used prairie and long tap-rooted native plants. So the prairie plants basically are native plants that have taproot systems that are almost 10 feet long. So imagine this. It's sucking in all the water and taking it into the water table. And this is why we use natives versus non-natives. Less watering, no fertilizer, no pesticide. Which leads me to the next issue of water. So we talked about how to increase groundwater recharge. And I'm going to take you to a place that's really close to us, Pushkar. So I actually studied Pushkar in my fourth year. I did a dissertation on both Udaipur and Pushkar. And this particular city revolves around this lake. You can see from the Google Earth's map that there are green spots right next to Pushkar. Those are actually farms. And I have it, thank you. And you can see the Aravalli ranges, right? Pushkar is basically kind of nestled in between the Aravallis. It's kind of a really beautiful valley town. The Nag Parbat obviously separates Pushkar from Ajmer. I think it's like 15 kilometers away. And the artificial lake, though categorized as sacred lake, is not 26 feet deep anymore. Some of the things that are going on here, along with the environmental degradation that happens along our religious towns, coming the sewage coming from the ghats, are the shifting sand dunes from the hills and the upstream interception by farmers through check dams for farming. So you have these inlet points that are coming in from the Luni River that feeds Pushkar, and there are these farmers that are actually intercepting it before it even reaches Pushkar Sarovar. This is what it looked like in 1992 when I was there studying it. This is what it looks like in 2009. Where did all the water go? So some of it is nature, right? We cannot fight nature. Some of it is the eutrophication that happens in lakes. In this case, though, it's accelerated because the Aravallis don't have much vegetation on them. So obviously, the erosion is happening and at accelerated pace. But along with that, there's also agricultural practices which the feeder streams, namely the Gomukh, the Nag Pahad, and the Savitri, are being intercepted. But something that's alarming me even more is the fall in the groundwater level. And why is that fall of the groundwater level happening? It's because of all the tube wells that have gone around Pushkar. So this is how the desiltation project at Lake Pushkar started in 2009. And people were just devastated. This is what it looked like. But after the monsoons, it did get better. The depth, however, was never more than 4 to 5 feet, even 6 feet maybe. The underlying issue, however, is the vanishing aquifers. So the problem with Pushkar is under the ground, something that you and I forget. And it's happening because of the fast rate of injections of these bore wells and the tube wells. So in order to combat that, there are recharge structures and settlement tanks that are occurring around Pushkar Sarovar. As we all know, the Pushkar city basically thrives because of this Sarovar. So we all have to make efforts to make sure that this is a sustainable city. And in order to do that, right now, we are bringing in water from outside sources and filling in the tanks. This is what Pushkar actually looks like today. If you see the images literally from, I think, fall of 2016. So I want to talk a little bit about how to clean up pollutants and make a site sustainable. This is a project that actually was awarded the Sustainable Sites Initiative. There are 12 projects in the US that got awarded the Sustainable Sites Initiative, and this one is one of them. And it's at the Morton Arboretum in Lyle. This is actually a place where I work part-time. I teach here, I teach workshops. It's a 1,700-acre site with 200,000 species of different plants, and it's part of a green corridor. And the project that I'm going to show you is the one that was done in 2004. It's the Visitors Center, and that's the one that got the Sustainable Sites Initiative. That's the Visitors Center and the Meadow Lake. This Meadow Lake is actually a retention basin. And right adjacent to the retention basin is, as you can see, the parking lots. The parking lots are made of pervious materials. They are pervious pavers. And the pervious pavers are on top of 4 feet of gravel. Not one, not two, not three. 4 feet of gravel and then the pervious parking lot. What that does is it actually takes the water runoff from the parking lot. There's very little runoff. Most of it is seeping right through, remember, because it's pervious. But very little runoff into the wetland and through the wetland into the Meadow Lake. What's happening in the wetland? Phytoremediation. Phytoremediation is basically plant-based cleanup. You're using plants to basically clean up the pollutants. And this is what Meadow Lake looks like in the dusk. It has a soul. It has the genius of a place, and guess what? It's completely man-made. And it's sustainable. Which brings me to my last project, which is a lot about community involvement. In this project, I was hired to actually design again a sustainable master plan, but the project emanated from them, the Illinois Math and Science Academy, wanting a memorial garden, a pond restoration, low maintenance, play areas, and demonstration gardens. So just to give you a little background information, IMSA, the Illinois Math and Science Academy, is basically a residential school from 9th graders to 12th graders. These are high-achieving kids, by the way, many of whom you guys might recognize. They are founders of PayPal, founders of Yelp, and a lot of these tech wizards. They come out of these amazing math and science academies. And they actually live there. They have hostels there. This is what the master plan looked like. I don't know how much you can see from your vantage point, but I'm going to try to make it quick. What we did is we wanted to make the demonstration garden right around the pond. We wanted to make the wetlands right around the football fields. The football fields and the basketball fields have the maximum amount of pollutants in their runoff. So we wanted to actually do the wetlands around that. And we wanted to do the demonstration garden right around the pond. In order to do this, we did a history of the site ecology. I don't know if you can see the old plan or the map on the extreme left, but the pink square is the IMSA site. And you can see that it was actually situated within a prairie. So we decided to go ahead and showcase three different habitats, the wetland, the prairie, and the savanna. And in order to do that, we really had to read the site. Site use map, site drainage map, wind analysis, site context, site soils, You guys, don't forget the soils, okay? If you're landscape, if you're doing landscaping, you've got to understand the soil. Site circulation. So we went in and proposed turf to prairie conversion areas. Little known fact, turf is almost as bad as concrete. Turf, the roots of turf grass is not even an inch deep. In other words, if you have rain water, it just completely sheets off turf grass. So we looked at converting these turf grass areas into prairies. We looked at converting the high pollutant areas into wetlands. And we looked at pond restoration areas. And with the memorial garden that we did it in a way that the pavers would be bricks with names of students, and the students' families could buy these bricks, and they could be designed in a way that each brick could commemorate a student. We wanted to bring in some mathematical patterns into the design, since it's for the Math and Science Academy. And I wanted to celebrate the Fibonacci series, and so use the Fibonacci spiral actually in the demonstration garden. So in closing, I basically want to say that you are going to be a better designer if you are a good detective, if you observe more. A good designer is a good observer. You need to observe land, you need to observe water, you need to observe vegetation, and you need to observe built form. What happens when you observe is that you find patterns. You find patterns in the land. You are able to actually listen to the land. You're actually able to listen to nature and use nature as a partner. Try to use nature as a partner when you're designing. And from micro to macro, try to find patterns. Like I find patterns in the fractal geometry of a seed head in the echinacea flower. I find patterns in the large matrix of the prairie. Why reading the site is so important. In closing, I want to want all of you to actually remember to do these four things. Bring out the unique aspect of each site, create timeless spaces, design with nature, and provide sustainable solutions. If we think globally and act locally, we are going to be able to have sustainability for all of us in all of our cities. And most importantly, we are going to give ourselves a sustainable planet. I want to actually close with a small patch of prairie that I have in my backyard. Thank you so much.
Now,